Okay, let's pray. Abba, thank you for your Shabbat. Thank you for Yeshua, our Messiah. Thank you for our holidays and the opportunity that you gave us to repent, to come back to you. Thank you for our Messiah who is our atonement. Help us to understand your word and your biblical holidays and help us to follow your ways. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. I'm going to do a quick review of these festivals, these main important, I will say, you know, a few important holidays in this season, in the fall season. We shall Rosh HoShana, the 10 days of Yom Kippur, and I will touch a little bit of Sukkot. Rabbi Scott and Counselor Kenneth Hoff will talk about this in more specific the next 2 weeks. I'm not sure in which order. I think Rabbi Scott is first and then Kenneth. So I just wanted to do a quick review about what the traditional literature mentions about it. A few things that I picked from the rabbis, from the Talmud and the Midrashim and the Gemara and some other rabbis. I'm just want to help you to understand, help you not to understand, but remind you that we're about to get into that season, which is very good. And then at the end, we're going to see how that reflects in Messiah, our Messiah Yeshua. And you see that everybody talks about the Messianic era, the Messianic age. And so, again, this is just a small introduction. On Rosh HoShana, we definitely meet our author, meet our the one who invented us, the one who wrote our story. And this is a love story that he wrote for us. And everything is in the scriptures. And we have the tendency of not to... The tendency will be that we read more commentaries than the Bible. And that's kind of not good. I used to do that, but now I'm going back to the scriptures and read whatever I need to read in the scriptures. And so this is Rosh HoShana, about meeting our author in Rosh HoShana. This festival arrives majestically at the beginning of the Jewish calendar year, marking the day of judgment and the stars of the days of old. This is an intense time of introspection, prayer, and striving for personal improvement. On Rosh HoShana, we coronate God as King amidst shofar blasts and begin the 10 days of repentance that culminate in the fast of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. So, this is what we basically do. Traditionally, we believe that in Rosh HoShana was the creation of mankind. It was the time of the creation. So, the Talmud Babli, the Babylonian Talmud on Rosh HoShana 11a says, Rosh HoShana is the anniversary of the creation of the world. Rabbi Eliezer says, what is the scriptural source which teaches that the world was created in Tishrei? It is stated, God says, let the earth uproot vegetation and seeds of fruit trees. Bereshit, Genesis 1:11, which is the month in which the earth is filled with vegetation and the trees are filled with fruit. This is Tishrei, for this is when the rainy season begins. So the rainy season begins, so that's what the rabbis believe is when the creation started. Let me find another, should I call it, commentary on that. The idea that the world was created in Tishrei refers not to the star of God's creation, but to its pinnacle, the creation of man. The first day of the actual 6 days of creation was the 25th of the previous month of Elul. It turns out then that Rosh Hashanah is the birthday of mankind, exactly. On Rabbah 29:1, refers to Adam as the first man who was created on Rosh Hashanah. So let me skip all of this reading and go to this. Rosh Hashanah is inherently a day of judgment because Adam and Chava were judged that day, as is highlighted in the Midrash. It is true that Adam and Chava were punished for eating from the tree of knowledge. They were banished from Gan Eden, had to work for their sustenance, and Chava bore the pain of childbirth. Nevertheless, the fact that they were granted life was viewed overall as a compassionate judgment and as a sign that they had pardon for their transgression. In other words, they were judged that day, but at the same time, God in his mercy didn't kill him immediately. He had the opportunity to kill him immediately, but he didn't. He just gave him the opportunity to do what? To repent. And that's what we have now. Out of all our sins that we've been committing, and probably the ones we're going to commit, God will be able to strike us immediately. But every year, every moment, every time, we have the opportunity to repent. And that's a good thing. He gave us that opportunity at all time. Rosh Hashanah has always been a date of judgment, according to the same writing. Said the Holy One, "Blessed be He to Adam. This will be a model for your descendants, just as you stood before me in judgment on this day and left with clemency. So the future generations of your descendants will stand before me in judgment on this day and will live with clemency." And which day is that? The first day of the seventh month, Rosh Hashanah. In Maharsha Hidushay Agadot, Rosh Hashanah 10b, it refers that God's judgment on Rosh Hashanah is performed with kindness and mercy. We conclude from this discussion that Rosh Hashanah was established on the first of Tishrei, since the world, specifically man, was created on this day. And on this day, Adam was judged for his transgression, and he did teshuvah, he repented, and God, in his mercy, who created the world, pardoned him. Therefore, our forefathers, Abraham and Jacob, were born on Rosh Hashanah through the attributes of kindness and mercy, which is assigned to their descendants, that they will be judged together with them through mercy. So it's very interesting how God really planned this merciful divine plan for us, to give us the opportunity to repent. We live, what, 70, 80, 100 years, some people a little bit more than 100 years. So we have all those years with the opportunity to repent. And we can do it in a daily basis, because unfortunately we've sinned every day, but we are justified, we are righteous because of the blood of Messiah. That's very important to come back to him on a daily basis. However, in this opportunity, this period of time, we are now still in Elul, and in a week or so, we're going to be in Rosh Hashanah. So we still have this opportunity to repent, to make amends with whoever we haven't made amends in a few period of times, or, you know, relatives, parents, or friends, or people from the congregation even, that we haven't really been good at during the last year. And Bethel and I has also a list, a prayer list that we can include in our prayers, in our daily prayers, so we can do this. One important thing that I want to refer you to is the Teshuvah is not a commandment per se. You don't have to repent if you don't want to. And that's a good thing, because God is not forcing us to repent. It's something that we got to do it by ourselves, something that is got to be born into our hearts. Repentance is not a commandment, again, which is, to me, part of His grace, part of what He is, you know, He's doing in our lives. Again, He doesn't want us to, He doesn't force us to repent, but it's important for us to do it. So, you know, it's not only for you to feel better, but, you know, it goes into, I'm going to explain later, there are three books that we are written, our names are written on, and there are three kinds of peoples written in those books. I will say four books, with the books of the Book of Life of Messiah. But the traditional rabbis tell us about three books. Now, on Rosh Hashanah is judgment. Judgment on Rosh Hashanah. Let's read a little bit about what the traditional literature says, the rabbinic literature. Talmud Bavli, Rosh Hashanah 16a, while there are four specific times of judgment for the world, Rosh Hashanah is when all people are judged individually by God. The world is judged four times a year, says the Talmud Bavli. On Pesach, for the harvest. On Shavuot, for fruit trees. I'm sorry, these are now my glasses broke off yesterday, and I'm getting a hard time with these glasses. Maybe it's my eyes a problem, not the glasses. Anyways, it says, on Shavuot, for fruit trees, on the new year, all of the inhabitants of the world pass before God, like Bnei Moron. As it is stated, the one who created sees together their hearts, the one who understands all of their actions. And on Sukkot, there is judgment for water. So, this is the time for the Bnei Maron. The Talmud Bavli, also the same writing, it says, everyone falls into one of three categories on Rosh Hashanah. This is very important. Rabbi Kruspedai says in the name of Rabbi Yochanan, three books are open on Rosh Hashanah. One of totally evil people, one of completely righteous people, and one that includes people with both good and bad deeds, the Beinonim. We're going to talk about the Beinonim later. The completely righteous individuals are written and sealed immediately for life. The totally wicked individuals are written and sealed immediately for death. The sentence for the individuals with both good and bad deeds is suspended from Rosh Hashanah till Yom Kippur. If they married, they are inscribed for life. If they're not married, they are inscribed for death. Some believe that this book of life is the same book that the book of Revelation refers to the book of life, when at the end of time, it says the books were open and people were judged by those things that they were written in those books. And one of the books refers to the book of the life of Messiah, the life of the Lamb of the Lord. So that's what, I don't care if it's a different book, but it's the book of Messiah. That's the one I want to be written, my name. I want that my name to be written in that book. Either it's this book or another book that he has, it really doesn't matter. I just want to be with my Lord, written in that book, and him to say, listen, questions at the end, my brother, thank you. And so, to me, that's very, very important. Now, Rashi, in the same reference, says, what is the definition of Beinonim? Beinonim, those with both good and bad deeds. Their deeds are exactly half and half. Brother, you might have a microphone ready for later. Thank you, thank you. This calculation is not as simple as it seems, because every action must be evaluated in context and weighted accordingly. And then Ramban, Maimonides, and Hilchot Teshuvah, Laws of Repentance 3:2, mentions that only God can know the true value of each and every action that we do. Let's read the reference. This reckoning is not calculated only on the basis of the number of merits and sins, but also takes into account their magnitude. There are some merits which overweight many sins, as implied by, because of him, there was found a good quality. 1 Kings 14:13. In contrast, a sin may outweigh many merits. As it says, one thing may obscure much good. The weighting of things and merits is carried out according to the wisdom of knowing God. He knows how to measure merits against sins. Can we see when somebody else is sinning? Of course we see it, right? Some things are really... You cannot really occult, certainly hide things. However, there are, in fact, the Torah this week mentions a list of secret sins. Have you read it? This week it mentions, Kors is the one who does this and that, you know, and it mentions like 12 secret sins. And when you realize those sins are really mention as secrets, because there are certainly sexual immorality, for instance, you cannot really do that in the open, right? There's something that, some things that, you know, is something that you hide to do those things. And so it mentions those things, or the other thing of hate, for instance. You can hate somebody and hide that. But for the Lord, you cannot hide. Now, how you apply certainly curses from that portion of this week. For instance, moving the boundary stones of your neighbor. How do you apply that to today's modern times? Well, certainly basics, certainly fundamentals of the Bible, you cannot remove them as your convenience. And so if you do that, you definitely are cursed. So we got to be careful when we say so-and-so, you know, is based on your commentaries, on your opinions, or is based on somebody else's opinions, or is in the Bible. So those are the things that we need to weigh. Like, what is a commandment? What is a tradition? And what is a superstition, which is another thing that we need to keep in mind. There are many superstitions in religions, either in Judaism, in Christendom, or in any other religions. So we need to be very careful. What is a superstition? What is a tradition? And what is God's commandment? And that commandment applies to me or not? That's the other issue. There are commandments for the king, commandments for the Levites, commandments for when you're in the land, commandments for the farmers, commandments for women, etc., etc. So those are the things that we need to really wait and understand if they apply to us. Rabbi Yisrael Salanter in Or Israel, Simon 31, says, every deed is evaluated by God according to, number one, the extent of the positive or negative consequences of the action, and two, the quality of the effort expended by the person to either perform the action or not. Again, this is all traditional. In some instances, makes sense, and for some, probably not. And so, let's move on. The judgment is for this world, not to the next. You know, there are two kinds of world, this world and the world to come, which is Olam Hazeh and Olam Haba. Rabbi Crospedai's simple equation of the righteous and the wicked does not seem to fit the reality we see before us. We can all name people whom we will consider truly wicked, who live on from a year to year. Many of us could probably also name righteous people who have died. How then can we understand the judgment on Rosh Hashanah? On Tosefot, Rosh Hashanah 16b, says, if good people are granted life and evil people are decreed to die, how is that we see good people dying and evil people living out the following year? Very good question, right? Let me answer that. I don't know. But anyways, this rabbi says, from the understanding that some individuals have the same amount of good deeds and bad deeds, and their sentence is suspended from Rosh Hashanah until Yom Kippur, it is implied that the definition of the righteous person is one whose merits are greater than his bad deeds. And a completely wicked person is defined as one whose transgressions overweight his good deeds. Sometimes, however, the righteous are sealed for death on the totally wicked for life. Therefore, the definitions of death for the wicked and life for the righteous refers to life in the world to come. So, you know, we always ask, why good people have to die and bad people stays almost forever, right? If you see those movies where the bad guy always gets out, you know, out of the fire, he's like, all over again. You know, and you're like, oh, man, how come this guy never died? And the good ones always die, you know. But I think God in his mercy is giving time for those people to repent. I mean, it's like I read a good thing about dogs. Why dogs die quickly, right? They only last 8 years, 10 years, 12 years. And you want them forever. Well, they die because they're good dogs, and they just have to die because they might have another opportunity, right? Have you watched the other movie, The Good Dogs Go to Heaven or something like that? And so, you know, you want people to be like my dogs, but that's not going to happen, you know. It's we are the reasoning ones, and so we reason that if we are stronger than the others will win, right? But that's not the biblical definition. So again, Rabbi Chaim Freilander from Sif Sei Chaim, Volume 1, page 103, says, the judgment for the world to come is only upon one's passing, not each year at Rosh Hashanah. In fact, some people die on Rosh Hashanah or might die during those 10 days. Good people. And he says, but this needs clarification for this judgment concerning the world to come. It's not on Rosh Hashanah. Rather, it is determined only when a person comes to the heavenly court after his death. So that's what will happen after our death, the heavenly court. It's hard to understand for us, the finite people, people who we have a small vision of the universe. We see it, and we see cameras and videos of people who saw it. Not people, but the technology saw that. But we don't have that kind of vision. You know, we don't see it. And we feed our minds from other documentaries about it might be life in other worlds and why we're not alone and so on. And, you know, maybe the aliens will invade us. Maybe they're good people and we're not and so on, you know. And so then David comes and says, who is the man that you come and visit us? You know, why you come down here and visit us? I mean, David is prophesizing Messiah right there. That he come down and visit us. Totally different of the idea of some scholars who believe that God is impossible for God to come down and be flesh. And that's the same idea of the Muslims. See, we've got to keep in mind that the idea, I'm going to say this and you might be in disagreement with me or not. The Muslims believe the same thing. That God cannot come down here and be a person.